lesson, so we know that now the G20 is over. So from the what they have achieved from this time, how do you recount this G20 summit in China?
Okay, I think China has done a great job this year with the G20 presidency. There are a few achievements that I see. First of all, for the first time, I think G20 has become more relevant for the developing countries. Because in the past, you know, G20 was established after the financial crisis, 1998, and turned into a leaders' summit, again through a financial crisis in the US this time. And it was much more like a crisis resolution mechanism. But now it's becoming something bigger by the help of China. And up until now, the agenda of G20 is much more asymmetric. You know, there are two tracks. There is too much focus on the finance track, which is relevant for the financial crisis, to deal with the crisis-related issues. But there is not much focus on the development track, which is much more relevant for developing countries. I think that asymmetry has been mended this year by this new focus of China on innovative growth, technology transfer, the ease of technology transfer, knowledge sharing when it comes to technological developments. I think this is a new understanding, and I find that a kind of a breathtaking, you know, it's a leap forward this time for China too, and for G20 and for the world economy. Basically, so I see this as a positive achievement for G20, and I think when you look at the content of the G20 agenda with this new focus on innovative growth, technology transfer, knowledge sharing, and also new industrial revolution, because this is the first time now there is so much focus on new industrial revolution also, and all the new technological breakthroughs in the final communique. I think G20 has come to the 21st century by the help of China. It has started last year in Antalya. You know, last year in Antalya, it was a kind of a breakthrough for many of us, many people like me, when the world internet was first mentioned there. But now all the technological breakthroughs, all the new industrial revolution related issues are included in the new communique, and that focus on internet economy has moved towards digitalization and digital economy related issues. I think this is an important breakthrough. So when I look at the type of Chinese presidency this year, you know, when I look at in general G20 presidencies, I see two trends. One is basically operational presidencies, and also there are transformational presidencies. I think when the G20 was established as a mechanism among finance ministers and central bank governors after the 1998 crisis, it was something new, it was an innovation, it was a transformation. It was transformational, and I think the Canadians were there at that time. Then after 2008 crisis, it was the Americans who turned this into a crisis resolution mechanism, kind of a crisis resolution mechanism, because that was the issue at that time. But now, by the help of China this year, we are seeing another transformation forward. So after the Canadians, at the inception, and the US in 2008-2009, now China has brought the G20 to this new age with this new focus on the growth agenda, basically. Because the nature of the growth agenda is now changing, and that's also changing the nature of the development agenda too at the same time. So I think it is kind of transformational leadership that I'm seeing for the first time in G20 after a long period of time. Last year, Turkish presidency was much more operational. You know, the agenda was set. There is this vision thing, but you know, it wasn't this transformation. This is kind of a new understanding now. So a new beginning for the growth discussions in the world economy. That's how I see it.
So for all those changing happens, do you see the cause behind this is kind of developing countries there because of their economy actually is at the rising trend comparing to the developed country, they are actually stopped or declining. Do you see this shift? And then now we saw like China hosting this time. Do we see a kind of the center move to the developing side now, the old world economy?
I think so, yes, I think so. In fact, the epicenter of the world in terms of the economic activity has been moving towards the East for some time now, has been moving towards China anyway, basically for some time. But I think in the past, when G20 was established, the problem is much more related with the financial crisis, the problems related with maintaining trade liberalization, open trade, basically, at that time. So the objective was to preserve the world economy as it is, the world economy as was established by the developed countries, basically. But now, as the weight of developing countries by the transformation of China in the world economy has been changing for some time, I think that center is changing. And the importance of more production-related issues also has come to the fore. You know, when you look at, for example, the Brisbane community, there is much more focus on finance, banks. If you look at the words, finance, banks, trade. In the Chinese one, yes, there is finance, trade, and banks. So that old agenda is still there, but there is a new growing, more production-related agenda also. And the focus is, you know, innovative growth, jobs creation through innovations, productivity, basically. So I think there is a shift, and that shift is, I think, useful. Useful for the growth debate. Maybe I can say a few words about that too, because when you look at the growth debate that started, let's say, in the past, that started in Brisbane, let's say, it's not this much exciting. You know, the growth debate at that time is about restarting growth. And both three dimensions of the issue were mentioned, monetary policy, fiscal policy, and structural reforms. But this structural reform agenda does not have much content. It doesn't have a focus. But now, with this Chinese shift towards new technologies, with this shift towards new industrial revolution, basically, now it is much easier to define a more focused structural reform agenda. So you need to do things depending upon the requirements of this new industrial revolution, these new technologies. You have to do things regarding the skills of the population. You have to do things in your education system. You have to do things regarding the infrastructure. So all the other issues, all the structural reform issues, I think, has achieved a kind of a content this time with this new focus on new industrial revolution, new technologies, and the spread of technologies towards developing countries. I think this is something very much positive. And the second issue is related with this growth is the development agenda. Because after the Paris Accord, there is now an agreement that lowering carbon emissions is something good. In the past, when we have discussions about lowering carbon emissions, it means it has a cost. It means that we have to pay with lower growth. Lower carbon emissions means low growth for countries like us, especially, who are trying to catch up with the developed countries. But with these new technologies, now with low carbon emissions, it's possible to achieve high growth. So that's why it's a kind of a win-win situation, and there is a good cooperation platform here between developed and developing countries. If we are going to make the world more livable for all of us, and if you would like to achieve a more sustainable framework for everybody, then I think sharing knowledge, sharing technological knowledge, finding ways, voluntary mechanisms, of course, for the spread of new technologies around the globe. And at the same time, underlining the importance of intellectual property rights. I think these are all the right issues that are placed in the new communique, and that's a new line of thought, new line of discussion that was started in the Chinese year. So I'm happy with the transformational presidency of China.
Sure, this is something. And so from this year's what we achieve and something new, do you see, how do you see the relation to the Turkish economy and development? Mm-hmm. What Turkish can gain?
Let me say a few words about, you know, the continuity between Antalya and Hangzhou first, and then I'll come to that. Regarding continuity, all these discussions, last year we started in the discussions under T20. So the Turkish leadership was also aware of the issue, but I think only China could have achieved this result as a major economy to start this bargaining process between developed and developing countries, because this is a new kind of a cooperation platform. So I think we started setting the stage for a discussion on these issues, but this year it was actually achieved in the official G20 line, and it was done, I mean, a comprehensive work was done on the official G20 side, basically, this year on this issue. So I see a continuity in terms of technology innovation agenda of T20 last year and G20 this year, and I'm very much happy with that, first of all. Secondly, you know, this issue of inclusiveness has started during the Turkish year, and I'm now happy to see that it's continuing. With the Chinese, both inclusiveness in terms of, you know, Africa, other developing countries that are not part of the G20, even this kind of an industry for Africa thing is a good move to, you know, move forward from here. So regarding inclusiveness, that's one issue, including other countries. And the other issue is about inclusiveness regarding SMEs, for example. And it's still there, both SMEs reaching, finding ways for SMEs to reach new technologies, finding ways for the SMEs to get into this new industrial revolution age as quickly as possible. I think these are all issues, and finding ways for SMEs to take a greater part in the global value chains. I think all the issues that are already mentioned here. And the I think that regarding the third issue, in terms of the continuity, is about, you know, last year one of the Turkish eyes was implementation, and this year I'm seeing so many action plans in the Chinese communique, and I see so many steps taken in terms of preparing new growth strategies, new plans for the future. And as President Xi has noted, you know, he was saying that this year, though, I mean, in the opening remarks of G20, he was saying that G20 in the last 10 meetings was basically worked as a kind of a crisis response mechanism. Now the focus should be to turn this into an international cooperation mechanism for better international governance for longer term policy perspectives. I think that's achieved now in the Chinese year, and it is good. I mean, it started in the Turkish year. Some small steps were taken, but I think we are now seeing a great leap here this year, in the Chinese year, and I'm very happy with that. Regarding the Turkish economy, I think these things, this innovation-based growth, technology transfer issues, structural reforms for technology diffusion in the countries, I think, are very much important issues for the Turkish economy, because now, up until now, Turkey has grown like China. China is still continuing that with internal migration. It's basically structural transformation. People coming from the rural areas, starting to work in the cities, in the urban areas, doing and leaving agricultural jobs, coming here to work in service sector or in the industry, basically. And that has brought forth a productivity growth in the Turkish economy. But now we are coming to the end of that. The urbanization rate in China is around 55%. In Turkey, it's around 75%. So from now on, we need to focus on new growth drivers, as noted in the Chinese communique. And that growth driver now has to be productivity growth in all the sectors in the Turkish economy. And there, the only thing that can create productivity growth in all sectors of the Turkish economy are these new technologies. Biotechnology, nanotechnology, digitization, all these things are important to create that productivity leap forward, basically. And that requires better, more fair, let's say, that's another word that's in the Chinese communique, in terms of trade. It talks about fair and fair trade at the same time. I don't think that the developed countries liked it very much, that idea, but I think and there is also, it's not only fairness in terms of trade, there should be fairness in terms of knowledge sharing too, about sharing technologies too. Of course, the IPRs should be in the picture, but there should be a mechanism, there should be a way to achieve more collaboration, more cooperation in terms of R&D, among the R&D personnel, in the science and development area, there should be more cooperation. And I see that all these issues are noted in the Chinese communique, and I'm very happy with that.